Hey everybody, Will here from Downtime Activities, back at last with some more Savage Worlds content. We have a lot more coming, and you guys have really been asking for it, and today we're going to go over how the character creation works in Savage Worlds. Kind of a step-by-step guide through core character creation and then the level-up process, and this video will cover both the Explorer's Edition and the newer Adventure Edition, so let's go ahead and get into it.
Like the vast majority of tabletop RPGs, your interaction with the world and the story being told comes through the lens of the character you create. It's what I've always liked about playing pen and paper RPGs like this. I love seeing how much influence you have on the world and the story, but while only being able to influence it through the actions of a single character. As far as creating complex characters that are automatically set up to be involved in their world, Savage Worlds is at the top of its class. Most of what does this is the edges and hindrances system, which is at the core of character creation. Since Savage Worlds has no classes, your character's abilities, skills, and drawbacks are entirely dependent on how you build your character. Everyone at the table could build a sort of rogue thief character, and there's no guarantee at all that they'd end up with even remotely the same swath of skills or abilities. Some fit better than others, but I really like that Savage Worlds gives you much better control over the creation of your character. It means that both outrageous specialization or jack-of-all-trades builds are equally easy and equally valid. All right. Let's actually break down how the character creation works step by step in the Savage Worlds system. I'm going to go over both the older Explorer's Edition as well as the newer update, which is the Adventure Edition. These aren't like additions in Dungeons & Dragons, which are complete overhauls of the system. They're just updates, and the system remains largely compatible. Don't worry, I'll go over where they differ over the course of character creation. Your character has a list of traits. These are split into attributes and skills. Attributes are your character's broad characteristics, while skills are a little more specific and tend to be trained abilities. D&D and Pathfinder have their ability scores and skill proficiencies, and this is the same thing. Now, one of the big things with Savage Worlds is that all of these attributes and skills are measured as a type of die, from the caltrop-like D4 up to the D12, which you always grab by accident because you think it's a D20. For attributes, you have agility, smarts, spirit, strength, and vigor. Agility is dexterity-based skills and things like ranged attacks or leaping out of the way of danger. Smarts is things like knowing history, thinking quickly, and just overall mental acuity. Spirit is like wisdom and willpower, such as fighting off mind control effects or getting past a fear effect. Strength is raw physical power and affects melee attack damage. And vigor is sort of a measure of healthiness and hardiness and affects your character's toughness. I'll get back to toughness later in detail, but think of it as the Savage Worlds version of hit points. Sort of, not exactly, we'll get back to it. When making a character, you have 5 points to raise attributes. They all start at a d4, so raising it to a d6 costs 1 point per attribute. The game ranks d6 as the average for an adult, so if you just put 1 point down the line, you end up with just a normal human being. Specializing an attribute means others won't raise at all, so you just have to decide on the balance. Since I like dexterity rogue characters a lot, I'd put more points into agility or spirit, and I'd leave strength a d4. Raising a single attribute all the way to a d12 costs 4 of your 5 points, which doesn't leave much to raise other skills. Now, Savage Worlds does, like D&D and Pathfinder, have a list of various species available to play. Elves, dwarves, humans, halflings, even android, bird-like, and cat-like options. These give relatively small bonuses, such as a single attribute starting at a d6 instead of a d4, or perhaps giving a free edge. But for the most part, I just use the human option in my campaigns, which get a free edge as their only thing. Obviously, campaigns vary wildly, so not every option will be available every game, and a lot of setting books just don't have this list of options at all. Here's where we get a bit of a difference in the systems. There are 23 skills in the Deluxe Edition rules. Boating, climbing, driving, fighting, gambling, healing, intimidation, investigation, knowledge, lockpicking, notice, persuasion, piloting, repair, riding, shooting, stealth, streetwise, survival, swimming, taunt, throwing, and tracking. Each of these skills has an attribute linked to it, such as agility for shooting, smarts for healing, etc. Unlike your attributes, which start at a d4, in the Explorer's Edition, your skills do not. At character creation, you have 15 points to spend on skills. 1 point buys the skill at a d4, and 1 point will rank it up until it is equal to its linked attribute. After that, it takes 2 points to raise it up per rank. This lets you specialize in skills your character isn't necessarily built for, it's just more expensive to do so. In the Adventure Edition, this works slightly differently. Skills like climbing, lockpicking, swimming, throwing, and tracking have been folded into other skills. Some skills have been redefined or renamed, like the repair skill being clarified, or investigation becoming the research skill, which was just an attempt to make the intended use a little clearer. Some new skills were added, most of them under the knowledge category. What we end up with is this list: academics, athletics, battle, boating, common knowledge, driving, electronics, faith, fighting, focus, gambling, hacking, healing, intimidation, language, notice, occult, performance, persuasion, piloting, psionics, repair, research, writing, science, shooting, spellcasting, stealth, survival, taunt, thievery, and weird science. In the Adventure Edition, you only get 12 points at character creation instead of 15, but 5 of these skills are considered core skills and start at a D4 for free. These are athletics, common knowledge, notice, persuasion, and stealth. I get why they did this, and I certainly don't dislike the new skill list. It was intended to ensure that those points you spend on skills stretch a little further, and that characters all have sort of a baseline and a small handful of skills so that the party doesn't always get nuked by the players in the group who didn't take stealth and couldn't sneak their way out of a building guarded only by statues. That said, some of my favorite moments in our own Savage Worlds games have come up exactly because characters had these deficiencies. I also liked lockpicking and tracking in particular being their own skills, but at the same time, this system, like most others, gives you advice for modifying rules at your leisure. At the end of the day, play how you want to play. After this, you have a short list of what the game calls derived statistics. In the Explorer's Edition, these are Charisma, Pace, Parry, and Toughness. Charisma is just a flat modifier and is totaled up from all of your edges and hindrances. Some give bonuses, some give negatives, so the total is your Charisma score. It always gets applied to skills like Persuasion, but can apply to almost any role the GM decides is fitting. Pace is essentially your movement speed, and is measured in inches, since the game was designed to be used with miniatures. Standard pace is 6 inches, or 36 feet, with another 1d6 as a run die. If you decide to take the run action, you roll the d6 to determine how much further you move. Like Charisma, some edges and hindrances can increase or decrease your pace, or change the run die you roll. The Adventure Edition doesn't have Charisma anymore, but the edges and hindrances that once would have affected that Charisma rating tend to just do the same thing by adding modifiers to the roll, which is what Charisma did anyway. Parry is like a D&D or Pathfinder armor class. In melee combat, it determines what enemies have to roll to hit you. In ranged combat, this number doesn't apply. Parry is 2 plus half of your fighting skill die. If you have a D8 in fighting, that's a total of 6, 4 from fighting and 2 from the flat bonus. If you don't have any ranks in fighting, your parry is a simple 2. Edges, armor, and some weapons can all affect this number. Part of what I like about this is that it takes your character's combat experience and skill level directly into account. It feels more worthwhile and realistic to raise your fighting skill if it's not just raising the die you're rolling to hit, but also making you harder to hit. Toughness is calculated the same way. It's 2 plus half your vigor die, and like parry, it can easily get raised and sometimes lowered by edges, hindrances, and equipment. Some armor raises parry, but a lot of armor, especially in modern day settings, raises toughness against certain types of attacks or damage. Now, toughness is sort of an HP equivalent system, but it doesn't really work the same way. Instead of having a pool of HP that damage slowly drains, toughness is a threshold. If you get hit with an attack, the attacker rolls damage. If it meets your toughness, or is only 3 points or less above it, you are shaken, which is meant to simulate a close call or particularly stressful moment that shakes your resolve. If it's 4 points or more above your toughness, you take a wound, and if you take 4 wounds, you're incapacitated. You can take multiple wounds from a single attack, one for every 4 points above your toughness the damage roll gets. Toughness doesn't change the number of wounds you can take, it only affects how hard it is to give you a wound. This is most of the core statistical elements of your character. What remains are edges and hindrances, which are the best part of character creation. Edges are a lot like class features or feats from other systems, and are a whole variety of things, from flat bonuses to skills, supernatural abilities, backgrounds, unique maneuvers, bonuses to certain types of attacks, etc. For example, the Alertness Edge gives a flat plus 2 to notice rolls, while the MacGyver Edge lets you temporarily improvise gadgets. Some edges you can only use once per session, some let you ignore certain penalties given by certain things. There are dozens of them, far too many for me to list here, and every Savage Worlds rulebook has some that are unique to that setting. Edges also have requirements, which might be other edges, skills at a certain level, or being a certain rank. Edges are separated into a variety of categories, like background edges, professional edges, combat edges, leadership edges, weird edges. Picking and choosing from multiple categories is how you begin to flesh out complex characters, and having them separated in categories helps you wade through the sea of options available. The lists are slightly different between Explorer's Edition and Adventure Edition, but a lot of the edges work the same between both lists, or only have minor changes. Some have changed a lot, however, like the Ace Edge, so if you're using both rulebooks, just make sure you're agreeing as a group which of the two effects you're going to use. Humans start with a free edge of their choice that you meet the requirements for, and you can get a lot more over the course of play, but in order to start with more edges, you have to take hindrances to balance them out. Hindrances aren't just negatives. They're structured as character flaws, scars, and story-driven weights that hang about your character's shoulders. They're vectors for your GM to get you involved in the story, or for structuring dramatic moments. Some, like One-Eyed, speak to specific events in your character's backstory, while others, like Bloodthirsty or Heroic, speak to personality traits that serve as a guide for RP. Some have statistical detriments, like All Thumbs giving a flat -2 to all repair rolls. Others, though, are only RP-focused, like Code of Honor or Curious. Hindrances are where characters become truly unique, and building a list of flaws and scars into your character creation serve as ideal guides for the course of play. The enemy hindrance is perfect fuel for story-driven encounters, and a GM is always going to take advantage of a character who is heroic to the point of it being a flaw. Hindrances are split into major and minor. In Explorer's Edition, you can take up to one major and two minor. A major is worth 2 points and a minor is worth one, for a total of 4 points if you take all. Adventure Edition changed this in a super minor way. You can take up to 4 points of hindrances of any combination. In either system, your DM might let you take more, but you should only get up to 4 points worth of bonuses. You can spend these 4 points on a small handful of things. For 2 points, you can buy either another attribute point or another edge. For 1 point, you can gain another skill point or double your starting funds. Now, on a personal running the game note, I'm not super thrilled about using this method to increase your funds, especially since there are good ways to do that with edges or cutting a deal with your GM, but hey, if you like the system in your own game, go for it. Most of the time when we make characters in Savage Worlds, we spend all 4 of those points on 2 edges. Since edges are such a big part of the characters in the system and add unique abilities and skill sets, it just seems to be the best option. However, everybody makes characters differently, so while I recommend you always choose your maximum number of hindrances, spend the points on what you want to spend them on. As far as character creation goes, this is about it. Once you've gone through your starting gear, named your character, and built your backstory, you're ready to begin playing. If this all seems like a bit much, the Explorer's Edition rulebook has a whole list of pre-built archetypes with recommended attribute ranks, skills, and edges. These are a good place to start, or at least a good place to look for ideas. They even go so far as to go ahead and list out parry, toughness, and charisma for all of their pre-built archetypes. So if you're short on time making a character, or if as a GM you quickly need a stat line to fit an NPC, this list is immensely helpful, and they'd be super easy to adapt to the newer system. Now, as far as ranking up is concerned, Explorer's Edition doesn't exactly have the same level system as D&D or Pathfinder, but it's functionally equivalent. In Savage Worlds, in general, the game is split into 5 ranks. Novice, Seasoned, Veteran, Heroic, and Legendary. This determines the edges you have access to, since some can only be taken by characters of a certain rank. According to the Explorer's Edition rules, you're supposed to earn between 1 and 3 points of experience per session. Every 5 points gives you what's called an advance, which lets you do 1 of 5 things. Choose a new edge you meet the requirements for, increase a skill that is equal to or greater than its linked attribute by 1 die type, increase 2 skills that are lower than their linked attribute by 1 die type each, buy an entirely new skill at a d4, or increase 1 attribute by a single die type. That last one you can only choose once per rank, but the rules on that change a bit once you pass the legendary rank. When you hit 20 experience points, you move up to seasoned, and at 40, you move up to veteran, and so on. By the rules, when a character dies, the replacement enters the game with 1 less advance than the previous character. Adventure Edition works exactly the same way, they just removed the experience points, so it works more like a traditional level-up system. From 0 up to 3 advances, you're at Novice rank. From Advance 4 up to Advance 7, it's Seasoned, etc. The ranks are identical, and the options you get for an advance are identical, but Adventure Edition lets you use advances to buy off hindrances, permanently getting rid of them. This has been a rule in Savage Worlds for some time, but it's not a super well-stated one, so it's nice to actually see it front and center here. Personally, I'd use this sparingly. Like I said, I think hindrances are one of the best parts of the system, and just getting rid of them all in a super easy fashion is going to feel cheap. Alright, here's a quick summary of everything we just went over. you have 5 attributes: agility, smarts, spirit, strength, and vigor. These all start at D4, and you get 5 points to rank them up. On top of these, you have a list of skills to choose from, which are linked to an attribute, and 15, or 12, points to buy and rank up those skills. If the skill is lower than its linked attribute, it costs 1 point, and if it's equal to or higher, it costs 2. If you're using Adventure Edition, 5 of these skills will start at a D4 instead. In Explorer's Edition, Charisma is a flat modifier affected by edges and hindrances, and in both systems, Pace starts at 6 inches with a D6 for your running die, Parry is 2 plus half your fighting skill die, and Toughness is 2 plus half your Vigor attribute die. Edges are unique abilities and are similar to class features from other systems, but since there are no classes, they're not restricted in the same way. Hindrances are things constantly working against your character, like flaws, old scars, or personality traits. In Explorers, you can take 1 major and 2 minor hindrances at character creation, with a major worth 2 points and each minor worth 1. In Adventure, you can take any combination up to a total of 4. You can also spend these points on edges at 2 points apiece, raising an attribute by 1 die type for 2 points, gain another skill point for 1, or double your starting funds for 1 point. Over the course of play, you get an advance, which lets you gain another edge, raise skills, or raise attributes, but you can only raise attributes once per rank, which is every 20 experience points or 4 advances. Well, for any of you out there wanting to get in Savage Worlds or working through creating characters, I hope this helps. Once you get the hang of it, you can breeze through main characters pretty easily, and I feel like the whole system is rather streamlined compared to some other systems. If there's anything we missed, if you have any questions about what we've gone over, or just any comments in general, feel free to leave something down below, and if you like subscribing or liking this video, as a small channel, it really does help us out a lot.
Well, I hope that helped you guys get a better idea of how the character creation actually works in Savage Worlds, and I hope it gives you guys a little bit better idea of kind of how the two systems compare and contrast as well. Like I said, they're not really all that different. You can kind of plug and play with both of them, but there are some differences and it's worth pointing those out. We have a lot more Savage Worlds content in the works. I don't know yet exactly when that stuff's coming out, but I'm working on a pretty in-depth Savage Worlds campaign that is going to show up on the channel. And unlike the Star Wars content that we're doing right now, that will be in a video format. So look forward to some more sort of teaser trailer stuff for that, hopefully in the near future. And in the meantime, go forth, slay dragons, sling spells, roll dice, and enjoy your downtime activities.